The views expressed on this program are those of the producers and individuals appearing on this program and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Sun Prairie Media Center staff, its video service providers, or the staff and elected officials of the City of Sun Prairie.
Hello and welcome to Real Reviews. My name is Jameson Rabbit, and this week I have a special treat because I am joined by my oldest son, Logan Rabbit, back on the program.
Hello.
Welcome, sir.
Hey, it's nice to be here again.
It's nice to have you back. Home for the summer.
Yeah.
And back on the program. We got to watch some movies together.
It's true.
We've spent a lot of time watching the Kenobi series.
Yes, yes. I'm enjoying it. Disney Plus, you know, it's hit or miss right now, but
yeah.
I like it. I'm liking it.
I do too. I've been
better
really
than the Boba Fett one series.
Much better, yes. And it is what it says it's going to be. It's about the character
right. That
it says it's about, more or less. But we're not here to talk about Kenobi yet. We're here to talk about some movies that we saw, and I'm going to get us started with our streaming spotlight this week when we turn to Netflix for Adam Sandler's latest film. It's called Hustle, directed by Jeremiah Zagar, and produced by LeBron James. We see Adam Sandler as Stanley Sugarman. Stanley has been a long-time trusted global scout for the Philadelphia 76ers. And after finally beginning to realize his dream of being a coach on the team rather than being a scout traveling the world trying to find new players, the new owner of the 76ers, the clueless son of the previous owner, Rex Merrick, played by Robert Duvall, his son, Vince, played by Ben Foster. Oh, you know he's nefarious. He's got a shaved head and a beard. Those guys
true,
are always trouble.
True.
The new owner, Vince, sends Stanley back out onto the road, very reluctantly, sends him back out onto the road to save the team. He demands that Stanley go back to being a scout, find that uncut gem that might save the team. So Stanley, one night, he discovers a street ball game in a park. There he sees a young man in work boots who is just destroying the competition.
Yeah.
And Stanley is convinced that this young man, a man named Bo Cruz, who's played by NBA player Juancho Hernan Gomez, he's convinced that Bo Cruz is that one in a million player and no one has ever heard of him. Stanley is willing to stake his reputation, his job, and everything he has, basically, on this kid. But there's a lot of work to be done and a lot to learn about Bo, where his past indiscretions and current issues on the court curtail the interest of the team. Stanley has to decide whether to cut bait or double down on Bo. Like you said, the film stars Juancho as Bo, with kind of lends an authenticity to the athletic endeavors.
Yeah.
He's an actual NBA
right.
player. So the athletic performance seems real. And I thought he surprisingly tackled the acting portion
yeah.
of it better than I was expecting.
Definitely.
From a, you know, a
I
basketball
think most,
player.
Most of the basketball players, because a lot of the basketball players that they had actually playing, the guy who plays Kermit was Anthony
Edwards,
yeah.
Superstar for the Timberwolves,
right.
Not Goose from Top Gun, different Anthony Edwards, but yeah, he's kind of the villainous basketball, the
yeah.
foil to Bo
right.
Cruz, and he's fine. I mean, he's kind of just running the usual trash talk.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
And that's why I thought that Adam Sandler brought a lot to this. I think he's really leveled up as an actor since Uncut Gems.
I agree. I wrote that down. I was going to say, I feel like I really like the serious roles that he's been playing recently, mm-hmm. specifically Uncut Gems. This one, both seem to both be about
They're
sports
They're both basketball
as well.
Related, if, NBA
and
related.
And I like that. I feel like he's finding that comfort zone where he can play what he wants, who he wants, in the role that he wants. I know, and basketball is a passion of his.
And he's not afraid to play flawed people.
Oh, no, definitely
Stanley
not.
Sugarman has flaws. He's self-deprecating, but he has flaws, and he's not afraid of that. And he's, you know, he makes fun of his weight all the time.
Yep.
But, I thought one of the interesting things was his wife is played by Queen Latifah.
Mm-hmm.
You see some of the dynamics between them and the push to believe in him, but also at some point, like, do you believe in this boy?
Right.
Do you believe in us? I like their kind of give and take. And I thought that was kind of one of the strengths of the film.
Yeah. I agree. I like the dynamic between a lot of the characters. I feel like, especially between like Bo and Stanley. Yeah, I like that. You know, it's like it's kind of like a fatherly role.
Yeah.
But he's you know, taking him under his wing, trying to teach him all of the different American social norms. I love the scenes of him in the hotel.
Yeah.
Where he's just racking up the tab on the mini bars. I like him constantly calling him cruise missile, and he's like, nah, it's stupid. Yeah. It's stupid.
Yep.
But he's laughing the entire way. I really felt like this was... I felt the passion in Sandler in this movie.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, it's something that he loves. He loves basketball. He's notorious as like one of the most passionate celebrity basketball players. He's always
I've seen videos of him just draining
he's
shots.
He's great. And so that's been great. I think the heart of this film, like you said, though, is the struggle to understand each other between he and Bo.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an easy road for them.
Yeah.
They go through a lot of things. And I like that. And I like that there's a lot of training montages.
Mm-hmm.
It's a sports movie. You should have lots of training montages. There's some Rocky-esque moments. It's set in Philadelphia.
Right.
Better have a Rocky-esque moment. Lots of basketball training sequences. You bring out a lot of the end one streetball players, the professor, all these guys. And then because you have LeBron James, you're able to use NBA teams, NBA arenas, NBA players. So it feels a little real to you, you know?
But I also liked the fact that, because I'm not a biggest like sports guy or sports movie guy, but I felt like it was easy to digest. It wasn't in your face, all a bunch of technical words and a bunch of, you know, run this, run that.
Yeah.
You know? It was just like, do what you do best.
Because it was the relationship more than
anything. Right. And that's what I liked. I feel like they could have told a similar story using any other medium, but I feel like, you know, choosing basketball with who they had, I feel like it did it really well without having to ignore the non-basketball fans. It still is an intriguing story.
Yeah.
I liked it a lot.
And I feel like Sandler really excels in sports movies.
Yeah.
He's given us a lot. He's given us a golf movie with Happy Gilmore. He gave us two football movies with Waterboy and The Longest Yard. Mixed results there. Uncut Gems is on the edges, the periphery, but
basketball
the Celtics, Kevin Garnett are huge parts of that.
Huge part of it.
And then this one where he plays a guy who just loves basketball, basically.
He's obsessed with it.
And I enjoy it. I want him to give me a baseball movie.
Sure.
Like, I'll take all of that.
Yeah. I really like this one.
Yeah. I love Ben Foster, and he plays despicable character in this one.
Is that
one.
The guy who played Vic?
He's the owner, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I love him, but boy, he's despicable.
Yeah.
One bad things to happen to him. What did you end up giving
Hustle, ended up giving this one 4.5 stars.
I really
enjoyed it. I was sitting there and just...
It says 4 stars up there. What do you think about that?
I texted 4.5
You say
stars.
4.5. We make it 4.5. Look at that.
Look at that.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed it a lot. And like I said, for not really a big sports fan,
That's big.
Really able to digest it down and to, you know, I know what it's about, but like, yeah, it's good.
I love it. Big surprise.
Yeah.
Big surprise. I gave it the aforementioned 4 stars. I enjoy it. It's a lot of fun, and as Logan can attest to, even if you're not a sports fan, it's got a lot of heart to it. It's got a great story.
Emotionally.
You have believable basketball, which is always key. So we recommend it. It's over on Netflix. It's called Hustle.
Yeah.
Now we had a big movie that
came into
the box office recently. Knocked off Top Gun as the number one movie in the country for now.
Yeah.
What are we talking about?
We are talking about Jurassic World Dominion. This is directed by Colin Trevorrow. Is the third installment in the of the Jurassic World series, taking place 4 years after the destruction of Isla Nublar, where the original Jurassic World was. The dinosaurs have relocated all around the world and are having issues assimilating into the world, both the wildlife world and as well as the human world. So this story follows Claire Deering, played by Bryce Dallas Howard, and Owen Grady, played by Chris Pratt. They now live in a secluded cabin in the mountains, watching over Maisie Lockwood, played by Isabella Sermon, who is Ben Lockwood's cloned granddaughter. That was the...
He was somebody in one of the previous movies.
I felt like I was supposed to remember this,
and I didn't.
She's the clone, his cloned granddaughter, and with the new company involved, which is Biosyn Genetics, mm-hmm. a research company looking to cure diseases using the dinosaur's DNA.
Dinosaur DNA.
Yeah, of course. Maisie, along with the cloned, like the, what was it, the asexual reproduction of, mm-hmm. of Blue?
Yeah.
Little Raptor. Yeah, Beta. They get snagged by Biosyn operatives looking to test her cloned DNA, see if they can do anything with that.
Sure.
On the other side of the world, giant swaths of equally giant locusts are just taking out crops all over the place. And so we connect back with Dr. Ellie Sattler, played by Laura Dern, and Dr. Alan Grant, Sam Neill, the original protagonists of the first Jurassic World or Jurassic Park movie. Mm-hmm. They go and investigate Biosyn Labs. When the Biosyn operatives, they're moving these black market dinosaurs with, they get stopped by Owen and Claire in Malta, and they get taken to the Biosyn laboratory, that's where, mm-hmm. Where they meet Dr. Ian Malcolm, played by Jeff Goldblum, and they convince, he convinces Alan and Ellie to help him investigate the eccentric CEO Lewis Dodgson and the, you know, stuff going on with the locusts and the crops.
Yeah.
It's it feels like a lot of this movie is really focused on the first Jurassic Park movie. Mm-hmm. It feels like they've been so distanced from it. They're like, all right, let's bring in the original cast. Let's make a very similar story. Show a lot of the props, like they showed the Barbasol and stuff like that.
Yeah, a lot of fan service from
that. It's a lot of that, and it's interesting, I guess. I don't know. If you and I were talking about this after the movie, it feels like if you've seen one, you've seen them all.
It feels like all these movies blend together outside of the original.
Yeah,
I feel like this has been a really rocky road for a franchise, particularly this recent trilogy, the Trevorrow trilogy.
Definitely.
He didn't do Fallen Kingdom. The second one, that one was my least favorite of all the Jurassic movies. But it feels like they just keep kind of rehashing similar stories. I can never in my mind sort out what happens in each one because it's all just kind of the same.
Yeah.
And it all just builds to a final act where dinosaurs are sneaking up on people and it's always raining.
This one heavily reminded me of the third one. Is that Lost Island?
No, that was Jurassic World 3. It was just Jurassic Park 3, I mean.
Or is it the second one?
Because the second one was Lost World.
Lost World. Okay, yeah. It reminds me a lot of Lost World.
This one, though, you're just like throwing together the old cast for nostalgia reasons.
Yep.
You have the new cast. Then you add in some new characters. You know, you have Ramsey Cole, who's helping them out. You have a pilot, Kayla Watts, who's helping them out. But
you also bring in people like Dr. Wu and stuff like
Dr.
that,
Dr. Wu's
too.
Back to kind of give him a little redemption to his story. But a lot of it is at the expense of some of the characters that we've gone to know. Like Chris Pratt, his character, I felt like he was given nothing to do other than hold his hand out a bunch of times.
Right.
To stop dinosaurs that he has no connection to.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, that worked on Blue because you trained those raptors from babies. But when the T-Rex comes up, you're like, whoa, girl. It's not believable.
Or was it the giant Allosaurus
or
whatever?
And I just didn't understand his arc at all.
I mean, I feel like their half of the story, because it was, you know, you had the two halves of the Maisie and Owen and whatever story, and you had the original cast story, looking at the locusts and stuff like that. I feel like this one, it was focused on Maisie. And I get it.
But I did like Bryce Dallas Howard
but
no, on that
you,
end of the
you
story.
Had, Claire had some, was, had some stuff.
It's she kind of had some moments.
You didn't give Pratt anything.
No, really nothing. And so then, you know, a lot of the movie is basically, who's the villain? Is it the dinosaurs or is it corporate
Biosyn,
greed?
Yeah.
Is it this villain who with a bad haircut and a Steve Jobs turtleneck? Is he the villain?
Well, because what was the locusts were avoiding their Biosyn?
Dinosaur locusts that were just killing crops and threatening the world food supply, but why weren't they going after the biosyn crops?
That's
the whole mystery. And I feel like outside of the groundbreaking first film, that this has just been, I don't know, it's been a rough ride.
Yeah.
I would have preferred you introduce a story where dinosaurs are now living amongst humans.
Right.
And I'm more interested in that story.
Yeah.
Show me dinosaurs and humans living together.
That's true.
We're one step away from the Flintstones using a woolly mammoth as a dishwasher or whatever.
Using them as cranes and stuff.
Exactly. But instead, you kind of give me a little bit of that in the beginning.
Yep.
A little bit of it later.
Uh-huh.
And completely go away
the rest
from it.
Of it is like, and now you're in the secluded and mountains in Italy.
Yeah. And it just, you know, I feel like it was kind of smart, I guess, kind of desperate to bring back the original cast.
Yeah.
Because they weren't given a whole lot to do either. I mean, I don't think any of them were given much to do.
I feel like Jeff Goldblum had a little bit.
A little bit. But he's Jeff Goldblum.
He can
read a phone book, and I'd be like, oh, that was amazing.
Love it.
And then, you know, unbutton the shirt yep. a little bit. I'm like, I'm there for you, buddy. But I thought the story was just kind of lackluster.
Yeah.
I mean, there were parts that worked. And like most Jurassic movies, I always feel like the third act builds to something really fun and exciting. Most of it usually is humans standing around watching dinosaurs fight other dinosaurs.
Yeah.
That's most third acts the rain.
I wanted to love that final fight scene. Just the fact that all of their fight scenes are always in the dark and raining, and they're just always close up on their heads.
Yeah.
I can't tell what's going on.
Yeah.
It's so frustrating. It's why I watch these movies.
And this is my issue with Colin Trevorrow as a filmmaker.
Yeah.
He's made two of these. He made Book of Henry, which is a horrible movie that came out a few years ago. He never seems to be able to get real emotion or human interaction right. I feel like he doesn't come up with believable dialogue. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel like anything that Laura Dern said, as great as she is, or Sam Neill, it was like
they were
literally
given
reading
a
script.
A vague script. Or no, not vague,
and
blast
just
script.
Everything is flat and surface level, and he never truly makes me feel anything. Yeah. And I feel like these films, especially these recent three, are more about like featuring set pieces that you remember than an actual cohesive story.
Right?
Like, well, we got to get to the part where they do this. And then we have to get to this cool part. And then whatever we do in between doesn't really matter. And it felt like Trevorrow just wanted to get that cool shot of the new heroes and the OG heroes together in one scene. Like, wouldn't that be cool?
With the old dinosaur
there?
And the new dinosaur.
Exactly. Like, isn't that symbiotic? Oh, it's come full circle. I'm like, it's okay.
Yeah, you did it. You checked that off. But I just was kind of bored.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not mad at it. I was just surprisingly bored in a Jurassic movie. I'll probably never revisit this trilogy again, where I've revisited the previous trilogy.
I've revisited the first two movies. The first two Jurassic Park movies are, especially that second one.
They're both great.
I love them, and I go back to them yearly or bi-yearly. I just because they're good. They remind me of my childhood, and they're
good.
Those
are Spielberg movies.
Those are Spielberg movies.
There's
and
a
the
difference.
The thing is, I went into this one because I did watch Lost Kingdom.
Fallen Kingdom.
No, the Jurassic Park 2.
Oh, Lost World,
yes. I watched that one right before going to see this one, because that's my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
And I was hoping that they would bring in the dinosaur into the real world like they did at the end of that one, and had it terrorizing the street. And they had, like, some news broadcast shots at the beginning, and they did nothing with
that. And that's what I'm saying.
And the
Give
thing
me
is,
more
they
of that.
That ending of Jurassic Park 2 was so good, because it was entertaining watching them drive this little Jeep around the entire city trying to bait it back to the dock. And it was like, you could have made a movie where you're rounding up all of them or doing something to make it more peaceful. I don't know, but they just...
Yeah, I kind of feel that way about this franchise.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know that we need more Jurassic movies. I get they make, you know, $160, $180 billion. Dollars. Like, I understand why you keep making them, but I just feel like they're all basically the same movie.
Yeah.
More or
especially
less.
Especially the world ones.
Here and there,
yeah.
But... Yeah, especially this recent trilogy. Like, I haven't been blown away by any of them.
No.
I do think this one's better than the last one, but that's kind of faint praise because I really didn't like Fallen Kingdom at all.
No, I didn't
remember a whole lot about it.
Yeah, this one wasn't bad. I think the word I summed up was just, I was bored.
Yeah.
Boring.
There's exciting moments.
But
especially in the third act, there's some exciting stuff.
It just takes a while to get there.
But yeah, it just didn't... didn't get me going
like
I was hoping for.
The one thing I can say, though, is it visually did look nice, at least.
Sure.
I think a lot of the dinosaur shots, I think a lot of the...
But that's kind of standard now. You should be able to get
that's
that.
That's true.
After Godzillas and Kongs and all these movies.
I tend to skip out on those the Godzilla monster big production movies. Yeah. I'm none of the smaller ones, but I don't know. I guess they continue to, I don't know.
Hopefully progress?
Yeah.
I don't know. What did you end up giving Jurassic World Dominion?
2 stars. It was just kind of meh to me.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah. I give it 2 stars as well. Yeah. It's very meh. It's not bad. It's just meh. Like, it's kind of boring. Do you want to see it on the big screen?
That's probably the only way to see it.
Knock yourself out. No one's going to be upset.
Nope.
Let's move on to our movie throwback for this week, where we are going back to the year of 2009 for a movie from director Mark Webb. It is 500 Days of Summer. Stars Joseph Gordon-Levitt as a man named Tom. Tom is a greeting card writer looking for love. He's a hopeless romantic who is caught off guard when his off and on girlfriend, Summer, played by Zooey Deschanel, dumps him. And this film is him looking back on that relationship, kind of searching for clues and lessons to learn. And along that reminiscence, he learns about himself in that reflection. And it's a series of non-linear memories. So it breaks some from the rom-com format that you would expect from a movie like this. Mm-hmm. You see painful moments followed by sweet moments, just like your memory would work.
Yeah.
It doesn't remember everything in a linear fashion. It just memories pop in and things trigger memories. And so we see day 316 and a memory there. Day 18. We see their meet-cute.
I'm going to cut you over here. I love the parallels that they would jump back and forth. Like they did the one at the IKEA where he's like, oh, the fountain's or the faucet's broken, and she just doesn't make a reaction. Jump back to, you know, 100 or so days, and she's the one messing around. Oh, good thing we got another faucet. Yeah. And, you know,
it's cute. And he has one person really who offers him sound advice, and that's his little sister, played by Chloe Grace Moretz. Yes. She gives him the advice to just not mope around thinking about what he lost.
Yeah.
Which is probably the best advice he'll get. And you see what Tom sees in this intriguing woman of Summer. And he has his own ideas how this should go.
Yeah.
He has the idea of a guy in a rom-com of this is how we go. We fall in love. Yeah. We take these steps.
You see a couple of parallel or splits where you get his expectation versus the reality. I liked that a lot.
I thought it was really smart.
I feel like a lot of the storytelling in this movie is, they do it really well.
Yeah.
I like having a non-linear timeline that, you know, it shows us what he's feeling now, or as, you know, not even at the end of the 500 days, just like day 300. You see how he was feeling, and then you jump back to see the flashback of why he's feeling this way about her.
And it's smart because it lures you in, I think, into thinking that this is a standard rom-com first. The way it starts, you think you know the way it's going to go.
Mm-hmm.
Standard, and it starts branching off, and you start to really learn a lot about them in a way that wouldn't seem natural.
Yeah.
By jumping around like that, you'd think you'd be kind of lost. But I feel like you learn a lot about their relationship.
Definitely.
His expectations versus hers and how divergent those are, how much he cares more than she does about this relationship.
Right.
And he thinks that it's something that she doesn't. And it's heartbreaking at times.
Yeah. No, I definitely was sitting there. I'm getting a little choked up feeling that little knot in my throat because, like, I get it. I get what he's feeling. I get that he feels a mix between lost but like still like that like attachment and he isn't fully let go yet but doesn't know if he wants to or not. Knows he should but just
even
can't.
Though it's thrown in his face that he should.
Yeah,
and I love their chemistry together. Yes. I think these two are wonderful together. I really enjoy both of them. I remember seeing this movie. At the time this came out, Joseph Gordon-Levitt was one of my favorite actors. Yeah. I thought he was great.
I still think he's great.
I do too, but he's not doing as many interesting things.
No, I agree.
And I fell in love with Zooey Deschanel around this time because she is just the cutest thing. And it's heartbreaking to watch these moments.
Was New Girl before or after? It was after this.
Yeah. And I think Joseph Gordon-Levitt is great portraying so many emotions and fragility. That's tough. You know, I really like that.
I love the beginning of that, like right after we found out that he gets dumped, he's just sitting there smashing plates.
Yeah. Yeah.
And his little sister is like bikes up to his two roommates and she's like, oh, what's it this time? And
yeah.
I love
They've
the fact
been
that
this with him.
I love the fact that his two best friends are like, you know, they're there, but they're kind of giving him the best friend advice where just kind of like,
yeah, they're giving
screw
the feedback,
her, whatever.
The feedback that he wants.
Right. And but yeah, he shows up to his 12-year-old sister's like soccer game.
Yeah,
is just sitting there like every time she gets a water break or you know steps out, come up to the bleachers.
And this is that young Chloe Grace Moretz from who's Hit Girl and Kick-Ass around the same time, who was just big and bold and brash. Yeah,
I love her character so much.
Yeah,
I did not expect it when I first saw it, but or like when I you know she first started talking, but I just. Yeah, she's funny. Yeah, she's great.
She is. There's a moment in here that now every time I've watched it, it sticks with me. It's a series of memories that he's flashing back on, centered, and it's kind of centered around them going because a lot of their memories, a lot of their time spent were going to movies.
Yeah.
And so this is centered around them going to see The Graduate, and you have this Simon and Garfunkel song Bookends playing underneath it. He's having all these memories and realizations, and starting to realize it wasn't all that it seemed.
Yeah.
It wasn't all just amazing. The veil has kind of come down on him.
Right.
And that one really gets me every time. Really enjoyable.
I really liked, because, yeah, he went, so there was like there was another scene where they went to the movies and they were at a parallel scene. So the first one, they would go see the giant or something like half vampire, half giant, which, great name.
Yeah, absolutely.
But then he's sitting in there alone and he's watching an artsy black and white film, but it's like all... It's him and his friends and his summer.
Yeah, it almost felt like it was him being thrown into the seventh seal is what it felt like to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know if I've seen that.
I don't know. It's a great movie. Okay. But yeah, it felt like he was thrown into that, yeah.
Yeah, because there's like a scene where they're just, they're like sitting there and...
That where he's playing chess with the kid?
Yeah, there's that one. I thought I had written down the word, but they're just, they're repeating the same word over and over and they're looking in different directions.
Speaking of repeating a word, there's a great scene in a park of he and some.
Yes, that's a great
word
scene.
To reaction.
I feel like that. Like they have really good chemistry. I feel like the two of them, both as characters and as actors, do really well on screen together.
I recommend it. I think underrated.
Definitely.
Rom-com. I guess rom-com. Com-rom. Classic.
It's comedic, but not always because it should be.
Right.
And it's not romantic, but it centers around a one-sided romance.
It feels real, though.
It
feels real.
I liked it a lot.
Good
I had
choice.
Not seen it before. I just was like...
Oh, this was your selection, Unseen.
Yeah, no, I was just... I literally looked up just words, or just like
just,
summer...
I just typed in words.
I typed in summer movies.
Gotcha.
And it was just like, this is the first... I was
gotcha.
Like, oh, I didn't know that the name was going to be a play on her name, but...
Excellent choice. Yeah. Well done. All right, let's move ahead, sir. Speaking of summer, we got a bunch of movies coming out this summer. I'm looking at the weekend of June 24th. With a few films. First one... Playing in your motion picture house is Baz Luhrmann's Elvis, his film about the king, starring Austin Butler as Elvis and Tom Hanks as Colonel Tom Parker. It's 2 hours and 40 minutes long, and I'm excited for it. Baz Luhrmann, kind of hit and miss for me. Makes some great musicals, makes some rough musicals, but I recently saw Priscilla Presley, Lisa Marie Presley, and Elvis's granddaughter, Riley Q, have all given it their love. But they went and saw it and said, it's great. Check it out.
Presley's seal of approval. It's got to be good, right?
Stamp of them. And then also in theaters on June 24th, a movie that I'm really looking forward to, it is a horror film called The Black Phone, starring Ethan Hawke, about a 13-year-old boy who is kidnapped by a child killer and locked in a basement. And then he starts getting haunting phone calls on a disconnected phone from beyond the grave. It looks tremendous.
Hey, ever since Moon Knight come out, I've just been watching Ethan Hawke movies a lot.
He's great.
He's great.
I know someone who saw this and said, it's the most disturbing movie I've seen in a while. So.
And I just saw men. So.
Yeah. And then lastly, we have a film called Rise over on Disney Plus, a film based on the life of the Antetokounmpo brothers, the first trio of brothers to all become NBA players. So that's over on Disney Plus. Before we go, we want to thank our sponsor, Marcus Theaters, the Palace here in Sun Prairie. Thank you for sponsoring this program. Next week, tune in while I'm sitting here with Steve Sabaki to talk about Lightyear and a host of other films. Sir, thank you once again for joining me.
Of course, anytime.
Bringing your wise opinion, I do appreciate it.
Yes.
All right, well, until next week, I'm Jameson.
I'm Logan.
Enjoy your summer.